Dickie Butcher was talking to Jack Key, who thought if they got rid of law and order, then he could become chief. So that, did everybody know that? Remember that, be sure to spout it out to somebody. They're one of the best lawyers in South Carolina. But here's a good one, this is also historic, from history. And I'm quoting this from the book it was in, the history book. In 1777, King George wanted a census of all the people in the colonies. Grafton County, New Hampshire, where Dartmouth College is located today, made this report through the county clerk, who wrote as follows. This is 1777. Your Royal Majesty, Grafton County, New Hampshire, consists of 1,212 square miles. It contains 6,489 souls, most of whom are engaged in agriculture, but included in that number are 69 wheelwrights, 8 doctors, 29 blacksmiths, 87 preachers, 20 slaves, and 90 students at the new college. There's not one lawyer, for which fact we take no personal credit for thanking Almighty and merciful God. They didn't know what they were talking about. I'm sure that's some sort of misquote. But I thank y'all for being here, and I urge you to get involved. Amy, as you said, what we found way back in domestic violence, we were wondering why the cases weren't going anywhere. Listen, political office is essentially looking for good ideas, finding out what works, and getting it into practice in South Carolina, whether through the law or just doing it or however you do it. But what we discovered back then, probably no surprise to anybody in this room, was that the victims are typically beaten 10 times before they call the law, before they take any official act. I mean beaten, hurt, 10 times. And then of those who call the law, about 50% will go through for various reasons. I won't do it anymore. I really love you and all that. And of course, typically you have a woman who doesn't want to, typically a man, to leave, but just wants him to quit. So she's giving him every break after break after break. And so about half of those 10% that call the law actually go to court. Once they get to court, half of them will testify for the defendant. So of all the cases that I know of, that is the one that has more cross currents, more surprises, more unknowns, more things that can possibly throw it off track than any other. I think there's a couple of cases that we have. There's so much psychology, so much is involved in it emotional, that none of which is, of course, is involved in the victim. So what we discovered was those cases were just, they were going nowhere. We discovered that the people would go to court on the appointed day, often have to bum a ride with somebody, have to find a place somewhere to keep the children. They have to go up there and they sit. Here come a DUI case, and here came a bad check case, and another bad check case, and then this and that. Before you know it, it's noon time to break for lunch, and then those that can come back, it drops off some, come back. And then the same thing keeps on going. They never get their case, and they put off to the next week, and of course, they probably can't get that. And we learned this from talking to Judge Lester Bates. Some of you will remember him, he was a city judge. He said after he tried about 300 domestic violence cases, he realized what I was just talking about that I learned from him primarily, and that is it different from any other case that you'll ever see. And you had a law enforcement officer who's prosecuting the cases. Well, law enforcement officers are good on evidence, good on blood samples, good on all footprints and what the witnesses are going to testify to. But they don't know anything about the rule of hearsay, know nothing about procedure, and it may as well be going in there with someone who just cannot possibly be expected to do the job. So what we did was we adopted Judge Bates's protocols, one of which was he had domestic violence day. I think it's twice a month. That's the only cases that would be heard on those days. This is just so simple. Why didn't we think about this 100 years ago? He had those days, after, so the only people in the room were the victims, their witnesses, witnesses on either side, the defendant, the police officer, and the lawyers, and we had a counselor whose name I've forgotten, who was a PhD, not in anger management, but in batterer's treatment. There's a big difference. And the deal was if the defendant pleaded guilty, that the judge, Bates, would look back and he'd ask, doctor, I'm sorry, I can't remember his flunk out, then the sentence will be imposed. That worked. Judge Biggs also told us you got to have the people at least 15 feet apart, otherwise the brute will be whispering to the victim that he's going to get her, and all those sorts of things. A lot of things that nobody had ever thought of. So we knew we didn't have the prosecutors and the solicitors. We went to the General Assembly and got $2.3 million for a dedicated prosecutor in all of the circuits, in all of the counties to try these cases. Some of them shared counties. Nevertheless, they were designated, and the different groups could coalesce around them and have a contact point to make things happen. But the key to it, as Amy said, was we asked for private lawyers to come forward. We would train them, we would deputize them, and send them into court to try these cases. And I think we went from somewhere like a conviction rate of about 33% to something like 70% in just a couple of years. And my understanding is the program's still working, and I hope that it's building. We went to Orangeburg and Kershaw and convinced two magistrates there, one in each place. Both were a little reluctant to try to do what Judge Bates was doing and let us provide the prosecutors and have CDB day and those kind of things. And it eventually caught on and spread a little. I'm going to bet it has not spread enough. So I ask for your help in doing that. There's no reason in the world. It doesn't cost any money. It doesn't require a new law. The fact that laws have been passed to stiffen the penalties and help in a lot of ways. All this takes is the will of somebody to do it in order to get that done. Now, there are a lot of things like that in this state. And I would ask you to be on the lookout for them. As I said, those of us in politics are always looking for better ideas from the platforms we have. We can spread ideas, we can educate, we can elucidate, we can get laws passed if necessary, eliminate loopholes and things that throw justice off. But if we don't know what's going on, we can't fix it. You can't do better unless you know better. So if you have ideas, I hope you'll speak up, because you're in a great position to do that. Now, back to this appointments and procedures for getting involved in the government, officially involved, other than in this way. There are all sorts of boards and commissions that are looking for people to be on. There are only three or four that pay any money. I think most of them will provide per diem or something like that. But I would urge you to get involved. If there's something that you want to do, let us know, let me know, or let someone that works in the office or someone who is in contact, or just call us. Or tell Peggy. Tell we paid you. That's one of my best sources of information right there. Peggy, by the way, I got to say, Peggy, if you have not been to the mansion lately, you need to come up. We need to have something. We like to get people to come to the mansion, because it is absolutely beautiful. It's 9 acres. Richmond Street used to divide the two blocks, but now that was closed off and it's been fixed up into a mall. There are weddings just about every night, every Friday,
weekend.
Every weekend night. There's always music. In fact, sometimes we got music on the left of us coming from the reception and music on the right coming from the bar. But it's beautiful. And what Peggy is doing is reintroducing, with the help of the Audubon Society and the Garden Club and other great organizations, is reintroducing more native plants in there to try to get more native birds in there. It'll be a sanctuary for the birds and those sorts. But it is a beautiful place, and we want it to be such that when we have visitors that come over, that they walk in, they say, man, this is a beautiful place. So that's our goal, because that's all that in the State House are probably the front porch, the front steps of South Carolina. That's what the visitors see. That's what we want them to see. We want it to be a place. And there's a Mansion Foundation, there's a Mansion Commission, that there are all kinds of. I think they'll have a handout. Is there? Do you have a booklet or something that's got all that in it? I can't keep track. There's so many. We have to keep up with the Secretary of State's office, but some people resign. And anyway, there are a lot of vacancies. Now, some of them are appointed by me, just appointed. Others require Senate confirmation. Some, of course, in the Senate confirmation process, require hearings. Some of them require a lengthy application. It's really, some people say it's too much trouble, but it does go into some detail. But I don't know. People tell me, I want to be in there. Tell me what I can do. Well, I really don't know what everybody wants to do. So I would recommend, look at that sheet. Or get a legislative manual. If you don't have one, come by the office and we'll give you one free. They're great little books. It's expression, this is a legislative state. Well, that's certainly true, because the legislature had more of a role in the executive function than most states. But nevertheless, that's the way it's been, so that's the way we work. But there are a lot of them where the members say you have a 10-member board, and 10 of them are ex officio by being the Secretary of Transportation or something else. And then the rest of them are selected by the congressional, by the House and Senate members in that congressional district. And as you know, some of the congressional districts may cross just a few feet into this Senate district or that House district. So you might have several congressional districts, and some of them might have 15 or so different House members or senators who have a piece of that district. As you can imagine, there's the 6th district that is just, that's Jim Clyburn's district, comes right through where we are. That's the district we're in. And it just is spread out all over the place. I don't know how many counties that touches, but everyone who's in that county, or whose district, House or Senate, is included in that geographical line, will have a vote on who the person is from that congressional district who will be given to me to either say yes or no to. So they come in all different ways. And again, some of them have hearings. The hearings, of course, the legislature leaves usually in mid-May. So it's a pretty speedy process of trying to get people through. But I urge you, if there's something you want to do and you know somebody who wants to do it, let's go ahead and do it and get you started. And what I'm trying to do is cultivate people who would serve on one commission here or one board there and get that view of how government works and how it intersects with real life. And then after they do that for a while and they want to go to this other, I took someone off the board of trustees of the university and put them on the Ports Authority, a lawyer, and took one from the Ports Authority and put him on the university. And I had some leave the Commission on Higher Education. I want to put them in other places where all those functions and understandings overlap. And if we do that, then the talent that is available in South Carolina is remarkable. I'm thrilled at the what I call the first and best. I won't go into all of them, but you know, athletics, we way at the top. Football, basketball, horseback riding, and all that sort of stuff. By the way, quick story. Manchin's a great place. Peggy was talking to a friend who said her daughter was graduating from equestrian studies. I don't know what the degree is. There's such a degree, I guess, at the university. They don't teach history and stuff over there. Anyway, this young woman was graduating, and they wanted to have an auction somewhere, and they didn't have a place, so Peggy, of course, volunteered the mansion. It's a beautiful courtyard out there, right between the mansion and the pool, which again, it's just the whole thing is beautiful. Well, it turned out the young woman's name was Backrack, his birth, Backrack's daughter, and he was going to appeal with his wife. It was not his first wife. This was he likes wives. So he was going to contribute a concert, and we found out later that they were saying that would be his last concert in the United States. And so we had the concert. He brought in the piano, had it in a little tent. It had three backup singers, two women and a man, and they were out there practicing. He was tickling the ivories out there a little bit. It was just wonderful. Then the people came in and they were auctioning off various things. And Ms. Backrack said, no, someone said, how about a party at the pool house? And Peggy said, okay. So
we didn't get any money. It all went to
the equestrian.
Equestrian. Yeah.
So they started bidding, and the bid went up to $2,000. That was the winning bid. It was by Ms. Backrack. And she said, the one condition is the party has got to be tomorrow, because it is Bert's 90th birthday. So they did, and we did, and they did, and it was wonderful. But I tell you, I never really appreciated the words and the singing of that man and his music, and Hal David was the composer, the words and Bert did, I think, most of the music. What a great thing. But I went back, as we'll get ready to have this, and I started listening, and there's one particular song where Backrack is playing the piano and Barbara Streisand is singing, and the song is Close to You. You just got to look at that, and if you want to see it. real talented. Of course, he sang that one. And he, she was not there, but he sang. You know, he sang Alfie. He said that's his favorite song. I never paid any attention to the words to it. I listened right there and listened to it. But anyway, spectacular talent. But that's, we have all, we have great institutions. We have great things in the state. But often we just, we don't realize it. And I'll finish with this. This is something I've always thought about. I've grown up in South Carolina my whole life, Peggy too. We met in Washington. I worked for Senator Thurman right after law school. She was a stewardess, called them stewardesses in those days, United. We came back here and I was making about this much money and Peggy was making about this much money. She bought our first house. Thank you very much again. But anyway, we have so much talent and so many nice people, and I'm tickled to tell you what these people from around the world tell me that come here looking to invest billions of dollars. You make a mistake picking the wrong golf club, it might cost you something. That's pretty big time. But you make a mistake in where you locate a $1 billion business, you've made a big mistake. So they make these decisions very carefully, and they look at all kinds of things. And you have certain tax incentives the county can give, the state can give. You don't want to ever overdo it. You have the weather, you have the port, you have our collaborations with the technical colleges. We have the best technical college system in the United States. That's where the future is, and that huge growing number of great, highly trained and skilled jobs that we need to fill. We're doing better than the rest of the country. We have all of those things. Brain power, the collaboration with research universities and these companies is extraordinary. We urge them all to enter into research and development agreements with MUSC, Clemson, or USC. But at the end, the thing that they all tell me, they say it in a different way, say the thing that the main reason they came to South Carolina was because of the people. They say it's the people. They're different from other people. They do what they say. They're loyal, they're smart, they're dedicated, they're hardworking, all those kind of things. And of course, we are a paradise with the oceans and the mountains, and all people really don't realize we have. But to finish up, I believe that it is the lawyers who understand how the pieces fit together better than anybody else. And like you, I've known a lot of people who distinguish themselves in a lot of fields. But it seems to me that the lawyers know how the pieces fit together. It's almost as if life is a maze and we never quite figure out. The lawyers often, through the things they handle for other people, the part of life they experience vicariously, it's like they're able to go up and look down and see the way the maze works. And that's why I'm always looking for people who want to serve the government in any way or serve in any capacity on almost anything. I think lawyers have a special talent, a special understanding that they bring to everything that they do. And you might have, Strom Thurmond told me when I was up there, he called me in his office. I was fresh out of law school. This is a practice here for just a little while, and then when I left. And he asked me to help him with something. I said, son, I don't know anything in the world about this. I don't know what this is. And he said, Henry, go and estimate yourself. He said, you are a lawyer. You have gone to law school. You have studied. You are different. Couldn't name them all if you gave me the rest of the day. There's so many, but they're all written down in